Good evening, everyone. Are my slides visible?
Yes, very well.
Yes.
So at the outset, I would like to thank the organizers and the esteemed speakers who have covered everything so well and given so many practical tips. What I would be covering is what the lesson we've learned from this COVID-19 pandemic is that we as ophthalmologists can still, despite the lockdown, provide the basic medical services or have a link of contact with our patients through telemedicine. And what we're going to learn in the next 12 to 13 minutes is how to do it better.
Go ahead.
Some problems moving forward. So I'll restart the slide sharing.
Yes.
Sorry for the delay.
Yeah.
Well, we yes, so WHO defines telemedicine as the delivery of healthcare services where distance and now exposure is a critical factor for the exchange of valid information for diagnosis, treatment, and prevention of disease. And what we're doing right now, continuing education for healthcare workers. So what I would say is that we can divide our lives into a pre-COVID, a COVID, and a post-COVID era. So in the pre-COVID era, also teleophthalmology or telemedicine was quite in vogue. Why? Because according to a survey, there was a highly skewed relationship between ophthalmologists and the population. There was only one ophthalmologist available for 25,000 urban population and one for about 2.5 lakhs of rural population. But what we were good at was we had 400 million smartphone users in India. So this was banked upon. And some very good strategies and programs were put into place. And this is how ROP screening was done. A lot of infants were screened and treated, and a lot of blindness was prevented. It was also used in glaucoma, also in diabetic retinopathy screening, especially artificial intelligence was being utilized. And they actually came out with figures like 51% of patients actually underwent laser who otherwise would have gone blind or would have had a severe vision loss. And this was also welcomed by patients because patient satisfaction has been reported about 88 to 98%. So this is about large scale programs. What about single practitioners? We used to get calls by post-op patients having some reactions to drugs or by a relative. And without knowing, we were actually providing teleconsultations to these patients. And then came a landmark trial in which the Bombay High Court convicted two doctors of a teleconsultation where a prescription wasn't given and also the diagnosis wasn't mentioned. So after that, the government and also the medical bodies started dissuading the physicians from giving a teleconsultation. And then came the COVID era. So after the lockdown, the teleconsultations have been reported to increase 100% every week. And it has been predicted to grow to an industry of $32 million. And we as an ophthalmic community, just in India itself, have organized and attended about 500 webinars in the past 1 month. So now the government of India also endorses the telemedicine and has come up with the guidelines in superposition with the Medical Council of India. And these have also been adopted by the All India Ophthalmic Society. So in the next few slides, we will see the do's and don'ts of telemedicine. We will try to answer questions like who all can do telemedicine, what all can be offered, can we refuse a patient, when all are we liable for litigation, and can the patients be charged for the consultation. So who can practice telemedicine is a registered medical practitioner. As long as we have a basic qualification and we are registered with the state or an MCI, we can practice telemedicine. There is also a caveat to this. So the government of India will come out with a training plan for doctors for telemedicine. So in the next 3 years, if you want to practice telemedicine, you have to take that certified course. We can consult anywhere in India, but mind you, the guidelines do not provide for consults out of India. Why I'm mentioning this is a lot of apps are linking the physicians to patients outside India. So those do not come under the purview of the guidelines that have been mentioned by the government of India. Now, earlier, what used to happen is, say, we'll take a case scenario that a patient calls us and says, doctor, I'm having a red eye. So what one would do is just ask the patient if you have any discharge, if you have any itching, or does the eye pain. We may or may not elicit a drug history. We may or may not ask for comorbidities or any systemic conditions. And we would just prescribe an antibiotic and a tear supplement. But now, since the government has given us power to practice telemedicine, we also have to be responsible of what we say and what we write. So I'll be covering the guidelines by another example. So now if a patient comes with a red eye and calls us up, number one is the consent. Now, since the patient is calling us, that means the consent is implied. But if, in any case, if you want to follow up a patient or the consultation has been initiated by the doctor, the consent is known as explicit. So you need a document by the patient saying that they are willing for the consultation. Patient's identification is also very important. We need to ask the patients and confirm the patient's name, age, email, and phone number. And likewise, we have to introduce ourselves, follow all the mannerisms of an in-person consult, and also tell about our qualifications and give our phone number and contacts. It is upon us to elicit a proper history. And we can also decide the mode of consultation. If we are doubtful and we want to have a look at the patient, we can request for a video consultation. If it's an emergency and the video is going to waste the time, we can ask for an audio call. Because the guidelines clearly say that the RMP should uphold the same standard of care as an in-person consultation, but within the intrinsic limits of telemedicine. This means that they trust us enough that we have the professional judgment and we are in the position to decide, and it's up to our discretion to actually go ahead with the consultation and plan treatment according to that, and also not compromise on the quality of care. So say now if a patient comes and calls us up and says, I have a red eye. Now, these are not guidelines mentioned, but this is just an example. A physician should take their own decisions in this, but say by history, we are suspecting an angle closure attack. So we can actually ask for a video consult. So this will amount to an emergency. An emergency in the guidelines has said that emergency means that the patient has to be seen in person. What maximum we can do is just given an IP lowering drug like an estrazolamide, and ask them to see the nearest ophthalmologist or yourself as soon as possible. If you think it's a uveitis, we can call the patient for an examination or refer. But if we think that it's conjunctivitis and we're quite sure and we can manage, then we can either counsel, provide some health education, some sanitary measures, ocular hygiene, and prescribe medication. And the prescription has also been given in a very specific format. It's pertinent for a registered medical practitioner to mention their name, registration number, address, and contact details. It is also pertinent to mention the diagnosis. And when we are mentioning the name of the medicine, it should be in capital letters, and also the generic name should be mentioned along with the dosage and duration. And it's important to sign and stamp the prescription. So what we can do is either issue a scanned copy, a PDF, or a picture to the patient. And it's also wise to keep a copy with ourselves. So now the consult is done. What do we do now? So we can charge the patient. It's actually written that we can charge the patient just as we would in an in-person consult. Now, after that, if the patient actually comes for an in-person consult or requests a repeat consult, it's up to the ophthalmologist to charge them or not. And we should issue an invoice after that. We are supposed to record the interactions, all the reports sent via WhatsApp, email, the prescription that we issued to the patient. So if possible, though this is not mentioned in the guideline, if we have a electronic medical record, we should link it to that. In case we don't have an EMR, we should not keep the data on our phones, because phones can be lost, can be broken. We should make sure we have a backup, like a hard drive or something, where we store all of this patient information. And then, though this is not mentioned in the guidelines, but still telemedicine has its own limitations. So what we can do is go a step further and just give a follow-up call to the patient, making sure they followed everything correctly and they're improving. And also then take a call whether to call the patient or not. So as an RMP, we can also interact with the caregiver. So if the patient is less than 16 years of age or debilitated, or the patient should be accompanying, then the consent is implied. But if we are interacting with the caregiver and the patient is nowhere around and is not debilitated, this again requires us to have an explicit consent by the patient to us that we can interact with the caregiver. Similarly, we can interact with the health worker with the consent of the patient. The identification of the health worker and the patient are again important in this. And it's still our discretion whether to trust the healthcare worker in giving the treatment that we want the health worker should give to the patient. So now say we have a follow-up case. Say we have a diabetic who has non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy and he's under our care for receiving injections for daily. And he gives a call, doctor, I want to follow up now. So if it's been more than 6 months since you've last seen the patient, this would be taken as a first consult and it would follow all the rules of consent, identification of the patient as would a new consult. If you don't remember who the patient was, again, treat it as a first consult and ask the patient to identify themselves and introduce yourself and take a consent. Or if the same patient has come and they've come with some different kind of problem or you suspect there's a progression of the disease, like diabetic retinopathy patient comes with a floater, you suspect a vitreous hemorrhage, then again, this would amount to a first consult and we should call them for review. But if you've recently seen the patient and it's difficult for the patient to come and they have a retina specialist or any facilities nearby, you can actually ask for the patient for their records like OCTs, FFAs and blood work. And the consult is paused till the investigations are received. We as doctors are not obliged to give our opinions till we receive all the information required to make a sound diagnosis and decision. So if you're reasonably convinced that everything is fine, we can advise the patient or choose not to advise, take a second opinion and call for evaluation. So the doctor or patient can choose to discontinue the consult process at any time. The doctor can also refuse a consult. Timings of the consult can be decided by both the parties. But after the consult, an emergency number has to be given to the patient as you would give in in-person consult. It is very important to take care of patient's privacy. Now, it's said in the guidelines that if it's seen that a software provider has caused a breach in the privacy and the RMP was not involved in that, then the RMP cannot be blamed. But if we ask the patient to join a group that we have made without their consent, that is also professional misconduct. We can also not add them to social media and we also cannot advertise that we are teleconsulting on social media. But if you want to send some health educatory videos, that is okay. So what would mean as professional misconduct is if we insist on the telemedicine when the patient is willing to visit. If we advise drugs from restricted lists like narcotics, psychotropic drugs, or if we advertise or induce, or if there is a breach of privacy. So to summarize, I would say that teleconsult, the same rules apply as an in-person consult. So before advising patients something, we should always have that in mind. It all depends on our judgment and discretion. A consent is mandatory as is identification. And again, it's our clinical judgment to call or refer the patient. And emergency means in an in-person consult. We can advise them to some measures, but this has to end up or follow up with an in-person consult. And documentation is which will save us later on. So the take-home message I would say is that telemedicine is a vital tool in the present times and the future, both for patients and doctors when reaching the clinics is so difficult and there's so much risk of exposure. And also a lot of our patients are in the elderly age group, but it is still a bane for the patients and doctors if exercised with caution.